analysis and also Simon Masaba for actually describing the general. Now we just want to get into the details of who was exactly General Tumwine. I have very senior generals here to actually take us through the moments of General Tumwine and with him. Before we do that, let's first take a look at the story. Who was exactly General Tumwine and his profile in that?
I can assure you, this is a great day of saying my institution is giving me a send-off, official, open, public, for everyone to know that run our race, completed our course, and we are ready to go. And even if I died now, what has God not done to me?
Eli Tumwine was born on the 12th of April in 1954 in Burunga, Mbarara District. He attended Burunga Primary School for his primary education. In 1971, he obtained the East African Certificate of Education from Mbarara High School. In 1973, he obtained the East African Advanced Certificate of Education from St. Henry's College in Chitovu. In 1977, he obtained a Bachelor's of Art in Fine Art and a Diploma in Education from Makerere University. He specialized in the history of art of painting. In 1978, he joined the Front Nasa forces led by Yoweri Museveni to fight the Idi Amin regime. He was awarded a certificate in Officer Cadet Course at the Tanzanian Military Academy, Mundori. In 1981, when Museveni formed the National Resistance Army, Eli Tumwine joined him. He reportedly fired the first shot in the NRA Bush War, which propelled the NRA government into power in 1986. It was in the same war that Tumwine sustained facial injuries that led to the loss of sight in one of his eyes. In 1984, Tumwine was named Commander of the Army, a post he held until 1987. In 1989, he was appointed Minister of State for Defense, a position he served in until 1994. In 1990, he got a certificate in Combined Army Course at Vistry, Soviet Union. Between 1992 and 2000, he was Chairperson Board of Trustees in the Uganda National Culture Center. Between 1993 and 2010, he served as the Chairperson of the Uganda Veterans Assistance Board. From 1986 to 1999, Tumwine was chairperson of the High Command Appeals Committee. In 2000, he graduated from the Uganda Senior Command and Staff College in Chimaka Jinja. Tumwine was also the longest UPDF Member of Parliament since 1986 to 2001. In May 2022, he was among the 34 UPDF generals that were retired from the army. Besides his army career, Tumwine was an arts teacher from 1977 until 1981 when he joined the NRA Bush War. In 1992, he launched the Creations Limited, a private company to promote the arts and crafts industry, encouraging artistic values and creativity. Besides visual arts, Tumwine was also a musician who composed some patriotic songs.
And that's why I say, I nunu.
The former security minister, General Eli Tumwine, passed away this morning in Nairobi at Akagan Hospital, where he had been airlifted recently after suffering complications related to cancerous conditions. He is survived by a wife and children.
Thank you so much for that profile, Rachel Nashuala. We are now back on air. We want to understand and get into details of the version and the perspective of the journalist that worked closely with General Eli Tumwine and try to understand who was this man and what type of soldier was he. This is a man who served his government from the time they were in the bush until the time of his passing on. Now joining me are three distinguished guests. That's Joshua Kato, a multimedia journalist here at Vision Group, and also a senior security journalist for that matter. Also Nathan Chiwere, a General Tumwine's documenter. We will be joined by Charles Etukuri, another senior security reporter later in the show, but we just want to first understand what the perspective these guys have towards General Tumwine. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me this morning. Let me start with you, Kato, Joshua. When did you first encounter with General Eli Tumwine, and what was it about?
I had heard about General Tumwine for a long time, even before I became a journalist. But as a journalist, I met him, actually called me, in the year 2001. I had a passion for writing stories about the NRA and the war in the bush. So I wrote stories on that January 26th of 2001. So he called me. Say, where do you get all this information from? So we talked on phone. I think I didn't have a mobile phone at the time, but he called the New Vision line. And they put me on. So eventually I met him at Nomo Gallery a few days later, and we had a very long discussion about and what he was doing to archive. So since that time, almost every year when I write stories for January 26th, the NRM day, is my reference. We talk. So I last talked to him when we went for the Birembo trek. You know, remember that Birembo trek in January 2020? Mm. I had time to talk to him was it Kasambia or some area there? And then my discussion with him was about archiving these NRA stories, because I had seen the other journals who were in the trek. All of them were becoming old. I told him that these people are going to die result of history and documented. So we talked about it and
it's right there. We will actually kick you from there. You can hold it there. Nathan, when did you first meet General Tumwine, and how would you describe him?
Okay, thank you so much. I was a student at the Makerere Art School up to the year 2000, and during that time they would invite different people to speak to us, to inspire us. And I remember General Tumwine featured quite prominently. Like most times when they invited him, he showed up. And he really inspired us to pursue art. You know, most people study art, but they never pursue it after. Yeah. They go in media. So, but also now my interface with him closely was when I started working with the media. I remember my first media house was actually the New Vision, where I used to write about art and culture. And I wrote a couple of stories about him over the years. And eventually I started working with television, UBC. Again, he featured quite prominently on my shows. The show was about art and culture. So yeah, through those interactions, we developed a relationship. And when I started now writing books, again, it was very natural because of our relationship for him to pick on me to start, documented a couple of things over the years, from little pamphlets, we even started a magazine, which unfortunately I think we had only one or two issues out. And now we have this book, which I'll talk about, I think, later on in the show.
What type of soldier was General Eli Tumwine. But before actually I pick Joshua's comment, I know he can as well. I've seen Joshua's pictures. You've covered many, you know, military stories and security stories. I last saw you in Somalia, how fearless you can also be like General Tumwine. But actually we'll have your comments later of describing who General Tumwine is and who or was, what type of soldier he was. But after this very short interviews on the street, Brian Alvins went on the street to find out how people, common people on the street or local or citizens are talking about General Tumwine. Let's first take a look at that, then we'll return with much more analysis and the description of who General Tumwine was.
Other country woke up with shocking sad news of now at the late Eli, General Eli Tumwine, who has also been serving as the security minister. According to different sources, it is said that he passed on from Aga Khan Hospital, Nairobi, Kenya. We've interacted with different Ugandans on what they really remember and what they have to say on the general when he was still alive, and this is what they have to say.
Abadde atubirirawo nnyo abadde ayagala nnyo omuntu wa wansi abadde ayagala nnyo boda boda mu Uganda yonna okutwaliza wamu era ng'amaliza yateekawo ne apex body ng'ayagala okuteekateeka omulimu gwa boda boda era bambi kibi nnyo omukama katonda amututte tera batuukiriza biruubirirwa bye naye ng'ayagala nnyo boda boda zeewandiise ayagala nnyo boda boda zeeteeketeeke bulungi mu Kampala so si kuzigobaganya era ffe nga boda boda mu ggwanga tudda mu Kampala okutwaliza wamu tumusubiddwa nnyo era tujja kumwerabira
amanya
amanya bampita tushaba ayibu
omugenzi omujjukirirako ki
omugenzi kye mujjukirako kimu yaleeta gavumenti eno mbuyinza ye musajja yasooka okukuba ejjaasi ekyaleeta omukulembeze muggwanga mpozi ekyennaku kye mpuliddemu bajeno baffe bafa baggwaawo naye nga bafiira mu malwaliro ngakumpi wano ngaate abasajja baleeta gavumenti eno mu mirembe mulimu obulwadde obusobola okuttira nga jenewo ngaoyo ng'alina kuba malwaliro g'amaanyi kuba yaleeta eggwanga mu mirembe wo kati oba tasobola kiba kibi nnyo okufiira e Kenya abasajja abaleeta eggwanga mu mirembe balina kuba nga obujjanjabi busookera na kwabo be ba Uganda be bataata ba Uganda era nze nnyumiddwa nnyo okuvuga ku maaso omwoyo gwe mukama agulamuza ekisa jeno
amanya
mpitibwa Kamale Patrick
omugenzi omumanyiko ki
generali
jeno atutudde ku maaso
jeno Tumwine
nze
jeno Tumwine ekyaddala kyoengeri gye sirina nnyo mu byagobera bya nsenzi jeno Tumwine mbadde simumanyi nnyo nga nze omuntu mumuwulira bubuzi mu bigambo
kikyotera omuwulirako
kyetera omuwulirako kulwanirira ggwanga abasajja bakuba amasasi kozi n'ebirala ebiringa engeebyo
tegeeza tugubirira nnyo byabufuzi
ebyobufuzi sibigoberera nnyo kuba ogolo byobufuzi togenda kulya mmere
ate right
togenda kulya mmere nekati nze wembera wano nga nkola emirimu gyange nengenda wajoyina ntubeera akakomando
Jeno Tumwine yabadde minisita w'eggwanga mu nsonga z'ebyokwerinda
mu nsonga z'ebyokwerinda
ensonga
z'ebyokwerinda zeezirirwa
ebyokwerinda eby'eggwanga minisita wa security
n'ate nga security ye ebadde eregeza security eregeza
Tumwine passed on yesterday from Aga Khan Hospital in Nairobi. Now with me in studios are two distinguished journalists, senior journalists, and they have been working closely with General Eli Tumwine. Joshua Kato, senior security journalist of the New Vision, and also Nathan Chiwele, documenter of the late General Eli Tumwine. Before I left, and we left for those comments from different Ugandans, Joshua had asked you a question. What type of soldier was General Eli Tumwine?
He was a good soldier. Tumwine, during the revolution, in 1979, there was a wave of young people joining the different guerrilla groups that had entered the country from Tanzania. And he chose to join FRONASA. FRONASA was led by Museveni. And as you know, Museveni had been his teacher in one of the primary schools in Mbarara in 1967. So I think when he learned that FRONASA was led by his former teacher, he joined. No coward joins. No coward becomes a soldier, you know. So he joined at the time, he had the education, already had a degree. So he joined at the time when there was a lot of chaos in the army. But he was lucky that he got a cadet course in Tanzania. Some of the senior officers at the time, all younger soldiers at the time, didn't get that chance of going to Monduli in Tanzania, but he did. And when he came back, of course, there was that issue of the other tribes versus the Lang and the Acholi, but he chose to stay with Museveni. So 1980 elections, he was a sympathizer of UPM, obviously, because UPM was led by Museveni. And when Museveni talked about going to the bush, Tumuni was one of the younger people who joined that first group to go to the bush. That was very courageous because, as we remember and documented, when they went to attack Kabamba, they were only 41. So he was one of the 41 first NRA fighters. The UPDF is now, maybe has trained over 400,000 people, but he was among the first 41. So you see, that was very big. Now, they go to Kabamba, and he does something that will fundamentally stay forever in the archives of the NRA and UPDF. In all military academies, they talk about it. He did fire the first bullet.
He did fire the first
bullet. The first bullet,
yes. Well, actually, hold it there. I just want to bring in Nathan. How did that bullet, the first shot of the NRA attack of Kabamba, distinguish General Tumuine from the rest of the other soldiers?
Well, I mean, it did. Although it's widely said, and he told me himself that that shot was fired in panic, out of panic. He was not supposed to have fired that shot. In fact, it caused them a lot of trouble. So yes, for firing the first bullet, he did, but it was not the intention. But yes, of course, like my colleague Katoa said, distinguished soldier. And what he did, I don't want to repeat now because it's been said over and over. But I really want to talk about the art life of General Tumuine.
We will get to that.
Oh.
I just want you to explain to us what type of soldier was he and how special was that soldier?
He was a fearless soldier, I can tell you that. I interviewed him a couple of times, and one of the last interviews we had not long ago, he gave me some real details about his, the guerrilla war, and how he got that injury, which again few people know, the kind of injury it was. People think he was actually shot directly in the eye.
In the eye.
Actually, the bullet went through the head.
What?
He was shot on the left side of the head, and the bullet went under the left eye, a few, just maybe 2 centimeters, and then it came out from the right eye. That's how it took the right eye out. And the doctor who first treated him wondered how anyone would survive. He said, this is God. This was an act of God. Not many people, there are not many stories like that in the medical field, you know? And he told me also that when that accident happened, they had a choice. They thought there's no way anyone would survive under the circumstances. So they put him on a bicycle, which had no pressure, and wheeled him to the next unit, which was headed by General David Sejusa. And a decision had to be made. So they say, this gentleman is definitely not going to make it. What do we do? Do we leave him to suffer in pain, or do we shoot him, relieve him of the pain? And General Sejus said no. I would rather he dies by himself. I don't feel, you know, they need to make it such a call. Mm. And somehow the man survived. You know, it was an act of God, and it's a day that he has lived to celebrate 1st November. Every 1st November, General Tumwine has celebrated that day until his death, as the day God gave him a new lease of life.
Mm.
And every day that he lived, he said it was bonus. He should have died long ago. And he kept telling me, actually, that I'm ready. I'm ever ready to meet my Creator.
Yeah.
So every year, every day, he's living an extra time. In football, it's called extra time. The real play time is done. They're just giving you a few moments to you know, to cover up the lost time. So for him, he lived in extra time for over 40 years. And
Yes, Kato, I want now to bring in here. This man was shot. You know, it's really shocking that actually this man survived and lived for many years. How special was this man that he even came, you know, from that injury and became an army commander and served government, you know, army in so many other various capacities? What could have actually been, you know, behind that kind of courage and the luck? Was it luck? Was it just the man was a very good soldier to actually fit in those shoes?
I'll take you back to what he told me when we were in Ibirembo. I did sit down with him and did, especially I want to know where and how he was shot.
Mm.
So, of course, they had been fighting for, now that he was shot on November 1st. They had gone to the bush in February. So they had been fighting for 10 months. Mm-hmm. Yes. And they had fought so many battles. Especially around the Bukomero, Chiboga area.
Mm.
So he told me his unit had a bicycle. I think he was commanding the second section of the inner. It was still very small.
Mm.
They could only have sections, not battalions or even companies. So a section has between 10 and 20 people. So there was a bicycle assigned to his unit. So when he was shot, his escort gathered him and put him on that bicycle.
Yeah.
You know, you were supposed to get first aid, but there is no first aid at the time, especially for the kind of injury that he had got. He was put on a bicycle, and I think they moved for over 30 kilometers before getting the first assistance, any kind of first aid. He was eventually sneaked out of the bush, as he has said, and brought to Mulago, and eventually out of the country for treatment. But surviving that wound, like my colleague here said, under the circumstances, was a miracle. It was absolute, because the bullet that goes through the skull and comes out, you don't get first aid immediately. You're on a bicycle. Some of his soldiers had run away. And some courageous guys put him on a bicycle, walked for over 30 kilometers to a safe base.
With that injury?
Yes, with that injury.
When did he come back to join the Bush War? And how did he even rise to the ranks of becoming an army commander? Because we understand there were so many other guys.
Yeah, so many other
active
guys. Mm. Yes. He appeared back either at the end of 83 or at 84.
Mm.
Yes. And he was named the army commander. He was not named because the NRA had grown at that time, and they were no longer the small 200 or 100 people.
Mm.
They now had thousands of fighters. They had attacked Masindi and got out of weapons. So they had even a brigade, mobile brigade under General Sari. But when he came back, I think rather than fitting him into these small formations, battalions and companies, the chairman of the high command, who
is the president,
deployed him as the army commander. I think he didn't want to relieve the other commanders from their fighting jobs, and yet he had General Tumwine, who was very organized.
Mm-hmm.
Fellow officers talk about him as a motivator. Mm-hmm. A motivator who, when even if you are frustrated or disappointed in the battle, you go to him and then he gives you courage to continue. So he was named the army commander, and then
to motivate the boys.
Yes. And then even after the war, he was named the first army commander of now the NRA in power.
What could have motivated this appointment? Because we understand that he was not present in the biggest part of the war, nothing. What could have motivated his rising to the rank of army commander, yet actually he was never present, or, you know, in the war for the biggest part, from 80 to 81 to 86?
I don't think he was really absent for the most part, as you might think. And actually, in addition to what Kato said, when he got the injury, he was sneaked. He traveled under a fake ID. Those days they used the graduated tax.
Yes.
So he got a graduated tax ticket of one of the fighters under a Muslim name.
Yes.
Went to Mulago, was treated for 1 month, and then his cover was bust.
Okay.
So when he discovered he was in danger, he had to escape from Mulago back to the bush.
Oh, and received much more training, rather treatment from the bush.
Yeah, but the treatment was still, you know, that such an injury would require a lot of time,
yes,
you know, attention. So the doctor was treating him, the late Dr. James Makumbi, had to go to the bush
to treat him.
So a cover to remove the stitches. they removed That's the quite, stitches from the bush. And somehow he had to continue making his contribution. Of course, eventually they sneaked him to, I think, Nairobi, and eventually, you know. So that injury took a lot of time, eventually to Cuba after they had taken over power. It really disturbed him a lot and took time to heal. But yes, he made his contributions, like Kato said, in certain different capacities. I think that kind of spirit, that kind of courage. You could have given up. You could have said,
yes,
I think I've played my part. I wish you well. When you take over,
yes,
I'm happy to work with you, but let me first, you know, take care of my life.
Yes, I'll come back to you, Nathan.
Sure.
I just want to pick Kato's comments on two very significant moments. When he was actually promoted to the rank of the general, how did you feel when actually that news came to you? But also describe to us General Tumwine from the time he was the chairman of the General Court Martial.
Okay. One attribute that God gave the late general was that he knew how to speak. He knew how to speak. He had a very clear voice when he spoke. And he knew what to speak. He was never scared of defending his uniform. In wherever he went, whether in parliament or he had skirmishes in parliament with several MPs who tried to abuse the uniform, including fellow officers of the UPDF. So we'll tell you, this is our uniform, we fought for it, and you have to respect it. So people who appeared, okay, it is not by accident he was the longest serving MP. He has been the longest serving MP until this current term.
Yes.
Yeah. Simply because he offered something different to the army. He could speak as a soldier, but he could also speak as a politician,
yes,
and a civilian, yes. He was well read, so he could give you several examples. So when he was in the court martial, the civilian lawyers who used to go there tried to intimidate him. I will not give you names. But, they tried to intimidate, but he always told them,
with Lego jargons.
Yes. This is a kangaroo court, this is a what? No, he used to tell them that, no, I draw this authority from the mighty UPDF. I was appointed here by the
commander-in-chief.
Yes. And you know what we are doing? He talked about the discipline of the NRA from the bush. She was a very disciplined officer, one of the most disciplined officers.
Yeah.
There were only a few utterances that he made, but he was very disciplined. So even the court martial used to refer to those doctrines from the bush war that helped keep the NRA disciplined.
We want actually Nathan also to explain to us one issue. How do you explain Geno Tumwine outside the uniform? Because he might have had his own personal life. How would you explain that life? Then we'll go to the issue of Geno Tumwine and the love for the art.
Yeah, like Katoa said, Geno Tumwine was very passionate about many things. We used to call him a jack of all trades. I don't know about master of all. Yeah, but he loved knowledge. He loved knowledge, and he read. And he was a gifted speaker. Mm. So that combination is quite lethal, you know? Mm-hmm. If you can speak, communicate effectively, and you also know what to speak, you know, obviously people are going to run after you for knowledge. People want knowledge, want to know. Mm. And for a man of his stature, Geno, who is willing to attend even the small functions, mm. you know, even in high school, as long as he has the time, mm. that's how passionate he was. Knowledge. In fact, he set up a knowledge center at Normal Gallery, I remember sometime, mm-hmm. and he would invite people to come and just share knowledge about anything, not military, not even art, about nutrition, about environment. How do we preserve our environment? How do we eat well to live, you know, healthy lives? You know, such thing. He invites resourceful people and he sits there and listens and asks questions. Mm-hmm. So he loved to learn. And for me, that was a really big plus for Geno Tumwine. At that level, mm. and he also knew a bit of everything, something small about everything. Mm. You know, you could engage him on anything.
one of the most interesting clip that we saw recently on the social media. I think it was last year when he was dancing with his family.
Yes,
I think that distinguished himself from many genos. We have never had them on social media. How would you describe that, Kato?
Yeah, he. He was, by the way, should I say, registered musician mm. in Uganda. So he had his songs.
Love for art.
Yes. Mm. Yes, he had his songs. And that was a way of relieving stress. You know, politics and the army are two
yes.
stressful activities. Mm. So there are things that he had studied at. And while other soldiers did whatever they did at university.
Some were lawyers.
Yes,
some were
they just abandoned.
Scientists.
But for him, even at his level as a general, he mingled with the artists, mm. whether it is National Theatre or Normal Gallery or other exhibitions. He did his designs. For example, the clothes that he used to put on mm. were designed by him. You know, he never put on. Sweet. I can see
yes.
my friend here putting on some of Tumwine's.
Designs,
yes. Mm. He never put on shoes.
Mm. But I had never seen him.
Yes, the things that put on were designed by him, told me everything, and yeah. He had a lot of music, even the music that you saw.
Mm.
He had his own music, a lot of it.
His own composition.
Yes, his own compositions. And you could be there listening to his own music. Laudire. So dancing with his family, I think it was a song.
Mm. It was a song, yes.
Whose name I have forgotten.
Yes.
But that was beyond so many genres that we know.
Yes, for sure. Mm. That
but
was
he had the personality.
Mm.
This other personality of a geno who is feared.
Yes. But his was quite a different
yes,
one.
A geno who never put off. Some people didn't even know up to now mm. why he never put off.
The glasses.
But. Mm. For me, when I went to see him the first time, he removed the glasses, and then I physically saw
what was there.
So
let's talk about Tumwine and the art. What could have motivated Tumwine into art? And was it did he get that talent from the family? What inspired him? Could he have shared that with you?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that question. So I've been wanting to talk about his art more than anything. Yeah, Tumwine told me how he was inspired into art by his mother. His mother, he was a Bahima.
Mm.
And the Bahima have strong visual tradition.
Mm.
Their patterns, you know, black and white, and mm. they use them a lot in their milk culture
yes.
and in architecture. You mm. find a Bahima heart with those, you know. So when he saw his mother creating patterns on their heart in the kitchen, mm. in the house, he was inspired right from childhood, and he knew from the beginning that art was going to be part of his destiny. And so when he went to school, he pursued art. I can't go into real details here, but yes, up to university, he got a degree in art. He taught art for 2 years after graduation, from 1977 to 1979, before he went, he joined the Liberation War. And by the way, his plan was to make a contribution to liberate Uganda and create an enabling environment for him as an artist to thrive and other people, and then go back into the art profession. His initial intention was not to work in government, was not to work in the military.
Mm.
But I think his boss had different plans for him.
Okay.
And now he's, the rest of his life was lived as a balancing act, a delicate balancing act between serving as a military officer without abandoning his passion for art.
Mm.
And as an artist, he did incredible things.
As an artist, he did incredible things. What are some of those notable things that you know that could be attributed to Gen. Tumwine?
Okay, first of all, Gen.
Tumwine, in the art life.
Yes. He was, in his own right, an artist. He was a painter. He he was passionate about painting the Longhorn Uncle cows.
Mm-hmm.
Those feature quite prominently in his portfolio. He was an art collector. He collected a lot of art, Gen. Tumwine. He has a whole gallery of artworks, right from the 70s to date.
Mm.
And then he participated in some major projects, by the way. For example, the designing of the new currency we have using today. Mm. He was part of the group. He was part of the team that created the Choga Monument. There's a monument behind Parliament.
Yes. Mm.
And there's another monument in Kabamba. It's called the Liberation Monument.
Mm.
There's a monument at Kololo
Independence Grounds
called the Journey. He was part of it and other projects. So he did quite a lot. And by the way, while in the bush, Gen. Tumwine he was still producing art. He had a portfolio, he had his papers and the tools. So it's not like all the time they were running around firing shots. During those moments when they were laid back, when they were taking a breath, you know, he would pull out he had a briefcase and draw and sketch. Unfortunately, that case got lost in the bush, and it's one of his biggest regrets. Each time we talked about art, was like, but my case.
Kato, could he have shared with you that and why he would actually resort to art when they are in the bush? We expect a general should be actually planning the war, engaging in art.
It was not always attacking or being attacked. You had some free time to do certain things. And then, like I said, the war creates a lot of stress. So for an artist, you know, when you have a talent, you can actually take away stress.
Yes.
Yes. So he did paint so many things. What he didn't say that he also the colors of the UPDF.
The flags.
The flags, yes.
Yes.
He was one of the designers, yes, of the flags. And even the first UPDF uniforms after, NRA uniforms after capturing power, he was one of the designers of those uniforms. So for him, art was part of his war.
Mm.
Even if he was in the bush fighting Obote, art was part of it. I think some people underrated, those who don't know him, see, he's not such a good artist, but it's only because he has the power.
Mm.
But when you go deep, I know Nathan here is an art critic.
Mm.
For so many years, he used to write for New Vision and critique those things. He wouldn't be appreciating Tumwine's art if it was bad.
Let's talk about music. Nathan, does he have any contribution that actually artists here in Uganda would say, this is Gen. Tumwine's contribution to the music industry specifically?
I can't speak with authority when it comes to the music industry. Yes, he was a musician, and he told me how his music journey began in high school.
Mm.
They had a teacher who set up a band, a student band. The teacher was the head.
Mm.
And Gen. Tumwine was among the, I think he was their tenor, soprano.
Soprano. Voice.
And they actually would go and perform. They would even come to Kampala and perform in bars and make some little money out of it.
Mm.
So he didn't begin singing, you know, when he was already, you know.
Mm.
And of course, as you already know, he wasn't singing for commercial purposes.
Yes.
I doubt he made any money from his music. It was a passion. Mm. Each time he had a passion, he would actually try to live it. And yes, I mean, I remember sometime there was another musician that was launching an album. Mm. I think it was called Geno. He's here, Geno something. He's in the US now.
Geno Megadi.
Megadi, mm. Who was my classmate at the university, mm. An artist also. And Geno Tumwine attended the show. He was promoting his show, this gentleman's show. And he went and performed with him live.
On stage.
On stage. Mm. And to many people are like, wow, that's amazing. That is quite amazing.
Yes.
So for me, I think that, and maybe other people we don't even know. By the way, not everything that Geno Tumwine did was out there in the public.
Yes.
There are things he did for individuals, okay, which we shall never know. So to that end, I think he made a contribution, but his biggest contribution was towards the visual artists. Mm. Remember, from 1986, he revived the art scene in Uganda. He became the patron of the Uganda Artists Association,
yes,
which I understand he helped to form. And that association played a big role in bringing together artists again, mm. And encouraging them to produce art and to exhibit. And he was the major link between the government and the visual artists, mm. In terms of voice, being their voice as a lobby, as an advocate, mm. For spaces. And to that end, I think visual artists in Uganda will be forever grateful
to his contribution.
Yes.
We are actually, we want to sum up this whole discussion, Kato, mm. But it seems like the original era NRA Genos are really going down. Yeah. And Geno Tumwine is one of them that who have been surviving. Seems like there is a huge job that these guys have not done to put whatever they actually went through in writing. Did you have a discussion with him about this? And yeah. What was his take? Why is it so hard? We don't know where to get this information
yes.
from.
My last discussion was 2020 January. Mm. I'm also passionate about the history of Uganda's various revolutions, right from before independence, mm. Through Amin, Obote I, and even now. Mm. So we talked about the issue of these commanders dying. Mm-hmm. For example, you know, out of the 41, I think only 8 are left. And the rest died with their history. Mm-hmm. So he had that passion of, and when I go back to the Heroes Awards, mm-hmm. He was one of the pioneers of those awards. And purposely to archive, you know, when you give you a medal, mm. You are recognized, and yes. So my appeal now, I'm going to appeal mm. to the powers that be, the surviving NRA, yes, they are still there, including the president, Geno Sari and the rest. There is need to do a third archiving of this history. You move through a place like Bukomero, where he was injured. And Bukomero has got a lot of history for the NRA. That's where the first casualty fell. A younger man called Kazawa was killed in Bukomero. But when you go through Bukomero, you know my drive through Bukomero going to Chiboga or even beyond, there's nothing. In some countries, there will be a monument there that our first casualty of the war fell mm. here on this hill. There's nothing. Mm. You go through places like Bukarabi. Bukarabi is in Nakasiki town. That's where Geno Sari got his biggest injuries of the worst injuries of the war. Mm. But Bukarabi remains a smaller village. There's nothing to show that something happened here, something that would have taken the best, perhaps the very best Geno in Uganda's history. There's nothing. So there are people who can write these things and put them down for generations to come. Mm. My appeal to the government is that this must be done soonest.
This must be done soonest. I will come back to you, Joshua. Nathan, what was the feel of Geno Eli Tumwine about archiving some of these issues, the stories? Because Geno Tumwine is for sure, no one can underrate his contribution to the liberation of Uganda's struggle. But these stories, we still hear them in words, not in writing. And we don't see monuments like what actually Joshua is talking about. What was his feel about this whole, you know, not archiving whatever that had that might have taken place during that time?
Okay, So General Tumwine was very passionate about documentation, like I said, at least starting with media. There's a lot of footage about General Tumwine that is in audiovisual form. Uh-huh. There are DVDs and, you know, interviews. There are really many. Unfortunately, the idea is how to put them out there, or how to put them into some kind of documentary and put it out there. But as far as books are concerned, we actually, he had commissioned me to write a book with him, one book every year until he dies.
When was that?
That was last year. And we started with this book.
You had only published one?
Only one. Liberated, as you can see. My Art Life.
Put it out there, we see. That's Liberated My Life.
My Art Life. So this was about his art life. But like I said, General Tumwine had many lives. And the next project we were working on was called Surviving for a Cause. Now that was a memoir. And he was trying to explain why God spared his life. By the way, it's not only when he was shot in the head. General Tumwine survived several deaths before then. He was beaten by snakes three times. Three times. Once when he was just less than a year old. He nearly died. And so he survived so many times. But so we started on this one and was supposed to do, if General Tumwine had lived up to 90, they would have had as many books.
As many books. Yes.
Because he made a commitment. And he commits to something, he never changes. Unfortunately, we didn't realize that we have the material, and I hope we can work towards finishing his book in honor of his memory, Surviving for a Cause. Yeah, but yes, I hope I answered your question. He was very good, very passionate about it.
Very passionate. Kato, I just want to get your parting shots, your comments, you know, finalizing comments about General Tumwine. What do you think the country is going to miss more about General Tumwine, and what do you think UPDF is going to miss about him?
Yeah, like, he was a straight speaker. He respected the UPDF uniform, he defended it. So on the floor of parliament, I don't think you can get another person who is better in respecting the passion he had for the revolutions. The revolutions were many, but yes, from the 70s up to now, somebody who can defend the UPDF with passion. You know, when you love something, you may make some mistakes. You may not even know that you're making mistakes because you are defending what you love. There are certain statements that he made in November 2020, November, during the riots. Statements that have been carried along after his death. But I think he was out of passion for the future of this country, that he may have overjudged what he was going to say, but yes, it was out of
passion for the security of this country
and the security forces. Yeah.
And that's what we are going to likely miss him about. Nothing. What do you think the UPDF and the entire country is going to miss more about General Tumwine?
Okay, so before then, let me be fair and say that General Tumwine's family is going to miss him. General Tumwine was a family man.
Yes.
Really, really big. He loved his family passionately. In fact, it came first. Then country, then art, then his cows. I think in that order.
In that order.
Yes.
Family, country, and art, and then cows.
Yeah, so besides his family, I think the artists' fraternity is going to miss General Tumwine. I can tell you on record, it's going to be extremely difficult to find a replacement. for a figure like that one who can fight, who has fought for the arts, all this. I don't know about the military, I don't know about the country, people have different views.
Mm-hmm.
I'm speaking for those that I represent.
Yes.
And having worked with him, because at some point I was the chairperson, the president of the Uganda Visual Artists and Designers Association.
Yes.
And he was the patron. So, and I can tell you that you it's going to be a big, big, big gap that we are going to miss.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Joshua Kato, multimedia journalist here at the New Vision and also senior security journalist here at the New Vision. Nathan Chiwere, Geno Tumine's, of course, documenter, has been discussing. We've been discussing the life of Geno Tumine, but we all know, and the viewers out there, we understand, we asked a question on our social media platforms that what do you say about the legacy of Geno Eli Tumine? Just join that conversation on our social media platforms at Urban TV Uganda on Twitter, on Facebook, Urban Television. We'll be reading your comments later in the show. Now, we all understand that Geno Tumine's love for the art is really immeasurable. Geno Tumine's love for the art is immeasurable. Now, in our next segment of the Rush Talk, we want to find out how Clever J, a Pamazi Wanani hit maker, struggles to fame. These are the grandsons of the struggle of the liberation of Uganda, and Geno Tumine's contribution is on that journey. Miles Ramiti will be returning with that discussion and much more. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Let's meet next Friday.